Hi everyone, and welcome back to the Genelec Immersive Audio Video Series. My name is Eric, and in the following episode, we're going to talk about the technical studio setup. So what components are needed, what devices are needed, and how they are all bridged together. Let's go. So let's have a look at the different components and devices that are needed in your immersive mix studio to make everything running. First of all, it starts with a playback device. Your playback device is most likely your digital audio workstation, being it a Pro Tools system or a Logic, a Cubase, a Nuendo, a Pyraminx. Basically, every DAW is capable of producing immersive content. We need a device where this mix has been recorded. So that is very crucial. And then obviously your monitoring engine is very important because you don't only listen to your immersive mix, you also have to dial in dedicated down mixes. So sometimes it's very useful to listen to the 5.1 down mix of your immersive mix or even to a stereo mix or the binaural output. So all of these things are taken care of in the monitor engine. And then of course, the physical speaker path, the listening path is crucial to everything. I already said that it starts with your DAW, the digital audio workstation. Your immersive engine or your production tools can either sit on the same machine or they can be put onto a dedicated renderer machine. For example, in Dolby Atmos, there's the mastering suite, which is a renderer running on a dedicated machine, which is then connected to your multi-channel interface because that's where everything gets rendered onto physical outputs that will feed your speakers. That is really, in a nutshell, the basic setup of how your studio has been designed. Let's have a closer look on your speaker setup when it comes to the monitoring path. There are two ways of operating your speakers in your immersive mix room. The first being the recommended version by driving all your speakers in full range mode. Full range means that your speakers are capable of reproducing the lowest frequency of around 40 Hertz, depending on the recommendations and requirements of your immersive format that you're working in. And they need to offer enough SPL at the listening position. So most of the models actually can operate in full range mode. And then what's important to know in this particular case, that the subwoofer channel, the LFE, doesn't have to do any kind of bass management for your other speakers when you work in full range mode. The subwoofer channel, the LFE channel, can either consist of one subwoofer or multiple subwoofers. This is depending to the size of your room, the placement of the subwoofers in the room. Giving you a little example, the Berlin Experience Center has two subwoofers. The reason for this is that the bigger subwoofer that was actually needed in this room would not fit into the design. So we decided to take two subwoofers, but one size smaller, which at the end of the day also allows us to have a better bass reproduction overall in the room by radiating low frequencies from two subwoofers. So there are many, many ways how you can deal with this. And the second mode of the operation for your speakers is with enabled bass management. Bass management means that your subwoofer, so the physical speaker, actually is taking over some load of your top speakers that either are too small, because you might have a small room and cannot fit bigger speakers. So it could be interesting to put smaller speakers in there and let the subwoofer help those speakers with a certain range of frequencies. And this is determined by the crossover frequency. During the calibration process in GLM, you can set the crossover frequency. Mostly it's around 80 Hertz, but it can depend. Basically, that means everything below 80 Hertz in this particular case is being played back by the subwoofer speaker, and everything above is being played back by the top speakers. And this can be used for all speakers around you. Often the top channels are bass managed because of insufficient ceiling height, so you choose smaller speakers in order to gain more height. There are many different ways how you can actually deal with this. And it also helps those little speakers to have enough headroom and in enough sound pressure level at the listening position, depending on the format that you're working in. Of course, the subwoofer should offer enough SPL headroom to accommodate this, and this is also dependent on how many speakers have to be bass managed over one or multiple subs. And this is not interacting with the LFE channel. And this is really important to know. Your LFE channel still is basically the channel that is fed by your multi-channel interface. But this has nothing to do with the base-managed frequencies that are generated outside of your interface. When we look into cabling options, how do we wire the speaker setup for my immersive room? We always have a 7.1.4 speaker layout, like as an default example. Can be more, can be less. But mainly, when you cable your speakers with AES-EBU, so digitally, it is pretty handy because two speakers can be fed by the same cable. AES-EBU cables always transport two channels of PCM audio, meaning that one cable can go into one speaker, and from there, there's an AES through connector going into the second speaker. So you could connect the left and the right channels on one cable to your interface. You can connect your center and your subwoofer onto one cable to your interface, and so forth and so on. So that's a very simple way of also budgeting cables, basically. You have less cables going into your room. When you look in an analog way of connecting the speakers, it's pretty simple because you just basically take every single output of your interface and feed it into discrete a speaker. Now, with analog, we can also offer partly base managed setups, meaning that, for instance, by the way, this is done in this particular room here as well, the front speakers are operating in a full range mode. So there is no need for base managing those speakers because they run at enough SPL, have the lower frequency range, things like that. And then you can say that if you have speakers, let's say in the ceiling mounted, that are a little bit too small for the particular case, you can base manage only these and run everything else in full range mode. Or you can decide to run your whole studio in base management mode, which would mean that you need multiple subwoofers. And those multiple subwoofers can either be like for the 7.1 speakers around you and the second one for the top speakers, or you can even split your room into left and right and have one subwoofer feeding everything that's on your left-hand side and the other subwoofer that is helping out for the speakers on the right-hand side. So there are many ways of dealing this, but be assured that we have a solution for this. Now we have talked a bit about the technical studio installation. What is very important for us in the studio as well is being able to listen to a immersive mix that is available on a streaming platform or maybe also on a Blu-ray or something like this. It's always important to listen to reference material. So when you think about this, where can you actually listen to immersive music as of today? There are a couple of options, actually, being the one of the major ones is Apple Music, the streaming service that is capable of playing back Dolby Atmos content. And this is done over either iOS or macOS, or it can actually run on the Apple TV little streaming device. Amazon Music HD is offering Dolby Atmos and Sony 360 reality audio content, either on the Amazon Echo Studio speaker, which is a little smart speaker available from Amazon. But they have also enabled every device to be capable of playing back immersive audio content that they produce and reproduce. Tidal, being one of the other bigger streaming services, is offering Dolby Atmos and Sony 360 reality audio content. And this can be listened over TVs, over AVRs, Android mobile phones, or also the streaming boxes like an Apple TV or an Amazon Fire Cube. There are many, many out there that are available. And then, of course, always around is the Pure Audio Blu-ray disc. And this is particularly interesting because a Pure Audio Blu-ray disc can handle multiple immersive formats on the same disc. So it's not only Dolby Atmos, it's also Aura 3D often, or DTS, DTS:X, 5.1, stereo. So many different mixes and formats to choose from. And now, for us in the studio, it's interesting and important, how can we make this available on our speaker setup? So the way how it works is we use a consumer AVR preamp that offers analog pre-outputs. There are even some which have digital pre-outputs or which have a Dante connection these days where you can listen to a Dante stream. Basically, the way how it works, you have your streaming device or your Blu-ray player, so being your Apple TV, your Fire Cube, your Fire Stick, connected over HDMI to your AVR preamp that offers multiple analog pre-outs. And from there, you can patch it right into your speakers, or you can patch it into your interface to make it available as an input in your monitoring engine, for instance. That's how we can stream commercially available immersive content onto our active speaker studio setup. This is an example of how these AVRs actually look like. So on the top right, you have all the HDMI inputs, being it your streaming device or your Blu-ray player or something like this. And then you can see a bunch of XLR analog pre-outputs. Yeah, with all these informations in mind, I hope this was useful for you to get your heads around how the technical setup in your studio will work. Again, if you have any questions, please feel free to get in touch with us on all channels that are available, social media, immersive.helpdesk@genelec.com, and also navigate to genelec.com and look out for the Immersive Hub. Thanks for your attention, take care, and see you next time.